Amen. You know, first off, I want to say I am extremely blessed to see mighty men of God and women who have dedicated themselves to put it all out for Jesus. You can preach. That don't make you a preacher. Amen. And I like what you said, brother. There's a lot of them get behind this pulpit and can preach up a storm, but ain't living none of it. And when you're out on that street, you are a mirror. And I've learned something. You have got to learn to be consistent. Somebody asked me the other day, what's a good place to preach? Everywhere. Because everybody needs Jesus.
Yeah.
I have preached when it looked like nothing was showing up. And God would move. Because we walk by faith and not by sight.
Amen.
Now how did I get started into this? Well, I was raised in an abused home. My dad left me when I was 4 years old. My mother died of cancer when I was 18 years old. Spent from 16 years old to 26 years old living in drugs and all this stuff, running wild, you know, and I didn't stay straight for 10 years. And then one day this woman I was working with said, I want you to come to church with me. I don't go to church. See, I knew where I'm from. There's three things that supposed to be a Christian didn't do. They didn't smoke, drink, or cuss. Today they all do that. Don't shout me down because I'm preaching real good. But anyways, I didn't know. The thing I knew about God was when my mother took me when I'm like 8 years old. The Lotus is all up in a station wagon and we're watching the Ten Commandments. And I woke up, you know, and there it is. God splitting the Red Sea.
Amen.
Woo! That's all I remember. But you know, growing up, somebody would sing Silent Night, and I'd cry. I didn't realize there's anointing on that song. You know? But then my mother died of cancer, and I remember Reverend Sam Marshall, Methodist preacher. He come up there and he said, brother, now we don't understand why your mama died, but Jesus got a purpose. And I just told him, if that's the kind of God you want, I don't want nothing to do with him. Because I laid in that, watch her moan and groan in that living room. And I ran away from God. I don't want nothing to do with God. Well, God gonna kill my mama, you can forget it. I have nothing to do with that. But then I remember going into this Pentecostal church. First time I went in there, they scared me. Some woman jumped up and started dancing. I thought, what in the world is going on here? And then there was another woman, and I guess she's full of devil's brother, and she started squeezing me with her fingernails and the blood coming off my arm. I don't want nothing to do with this place. So finally, I went back one more time. Thank God I did. I heard the preacher. He got up here and he said, now, if any of you gonna say anything to God, come on up here. I said, okay, Lord, I got something to say to you. Uh-oh. I believe in being real. You understand? I already knew I was messed up. God knew I was messed up. And listen, it's no secret God knows you're sinning. He already sees it. Problem is, we've got to learn to repent. Amen?
Yeah.
Anyways, I get up there. I'm talking to God. Here's what I said to him, brother. I said, if you're real, I want you. And if you're not, leave me alone.
Okay.
I didn't know the sinner's prayer. I'm talking to God. First time I ever talked to him. I messed the camera up.
Yeah, this is the walk of the aisle.
I can't help. We're not on the street, are we? Action. All right, but anyways, they don't need to see me. They can hear me.
Hey, we want to see you.
You can break me up already, brother. Anyway, Kevin knows me. He can tell you something about me. Anyways, make a long story short, whether you believe or not, I don't care less. But that night, I'm awake. My eyes are wide awake. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. I go, whoa. I woke up the next day. We talking about somebody who took uppers and downers and dope and never stayed straight. Always stoned. Woke up the next day. Woo! Straight. This is new. Never been like this. I didn't ask God to deliver me. It came with the package. I appreciated it. And then I heard him say, I have delivered you. Don't you ever go back into that again.
That's right.
Well, that's what he told that one person, didn't he? Don't sin no more.
Amen.
Amen. Well, I had enough sense to know that, you know, I've been on some space trips. I've gotten so high I didn't leave my apartment. But I'm telling you, I knew that was real. And I thought everybody wanted Jesus. I went down there. I went back to work. And my boss said, where you been? I've been with God. And, you know, and then I'm in my room there, and somebody gives me a record from the Laney Wolf Trio. Said, my house is full and my fields are empty. Who will go work for me today? I'm taking a shower, and I'm starting to cry. I'm hearing God talking to me. I said, Lord, are you telling me you want me to work? Mm-hmm. And so, am I 10 minutes already up?
You're getting close. 5 minutes.
And then I'm supposed to do this other thing?
Yes, yeah. Just how you get started.
All right, well, you know me. Just pull the switch, okay? Anyways, make a long story short. I heard the Lord tell me, he said, I don't want you to tell people what I've done for you. I said, I don't know the Bible. I ain't no preacher. He said, you got a testimony, don't you? So I went to where I used to hang out at, all the bars and the clubs. I lived in a little town called Parkersburg, West Virginia. One street was 7th Street. You could go to the whorehouse, you go to anywhere you wanted to go. By the time you start on one side by the end of the street, you're loaded, you're lipped, and you're out of your mind. Didn't have to leave the street. And I said, Lord, where you want to go? He said, go stand outside these clubs and bars. Well, I got scared. I'd wait for a drunk to pass out. And then I'd sit him on the curb.
Yeah.
And I'd start talking to him.
There you go.
That'll work. I mean, you gotta ride a tricycle before you can get on a bicycle.
That'll work.
Amen.
Amen.
And I mean, I was shaking like this and I was so nervous. But then I felt God in this thing. You know? And then one night I was out there and a guy come out with a claw hammer. And I didn't know about how to cast out devils. I didn't know about deliverance. I just cried out, Jesus! And the guy just dropped a hammer and ran off. Woo! This is something I've learned about that. I didn't learn that in the first church. And so I started leading a couple guys that used to run in to sell dope and took them back to the church. Hair down to here. Brought them into church. And I said, they said, where'd these guys come from? Same place I did. The street. And they said, this is supposed to be my brethren. And it's funny because after I got the Holy Ghost, they pray for me. Oh, I'm praying for you, brother, that they let you get close to God. Yes, Lord, use him mightily. They did, they threw me out. And I'm crying outside of the church. Oh, Jesus, they don't want me. He said, Roger, they have not wanted me for the last 30 years. And that's what's wrong with a lot of people. They're doing the work of the church. They're not doing the work of Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
And what I'm seeing in here today is those who don't want to be the usher. Thank God for ushers. I pastored the church. I thank God we had a clean toilet. If they didn't clean it, bless God, I was going to clean it. But I look in a room and I look in the eyes of people who have paid the price. You have to pay a price to do what we're doing. You have to make a decision today. That's why I've seen them come and go. Reuben knows it. You know it. You can give them a banner. They're all hyped up. They're ready to go until the first time the persecution comes. Till the first time somebody's going to gut you out like a fish. true disciple of Jesus doesn't look back. He looks ahead.
Amen.
Amen. That's my 10 minutes?
Amen.
Amen.